We have the Standerwick family, I think, coming today. Remembering Bill, a loving husband, a wonderful dad, a great grandpa, someone we all know and we loved. He's a great guy, guy's guy. I loved his laugh. Right? So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life we're celebrating today. We stand in your promise, Lord, that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We thank you that he is in no more pain. He's singing songs of praise. He's with his Father in heaven. We thank you that he knew you. He praised you for his life. And Father, may we remember the family. We love them. We know them. We pray that your Holy Spirit, comfort that only you can give, will wrap them around themselves. And Father, comfort them in this time. And today as we celebrate, I pray you'll be with them. Be with the friends here today. We look around us and see many people that have celebrated the life of Bill as he lived and has come here together today. So Father, bless this time together. And we'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing some songs that have been chosen. Some of Bill's favorites, so let's sing this together.
The standard of the King, clothed in majesty, then all the earth rejoices. All the earth rejoices. He bows himself in love, and darkness tries to hide and trembles out.
Hi, my name is Beth, and I am Bill's sister. And I want to thank you all for coming this afternoon to celebrate, honor, and remember Bill. Husband, father, grandfather, brother, friend, and dentist. As I think about Bill, my first memory is as a little girl standing at the end of the lane, waiting excitedly and impatiently for my big brother to come home from school at Lord Kitchener. It was always a really joyful reunion. And as a young boy, and then as a man, he always had a very special way of making those he crossed paths with feel special, valued, and loved. Bill was a good student and was a lifelong learner. After attending Lord Byng High School, he went to UBC to begin his science degree, which would lead him to dentistry. During this time, he met Jeanette. Bill loved Jeanette, and Jeanette loved Bill. Jeanette, you were a gift from God and were exactly the woman Bill needed. You loved him deeply, always supported him, and took exceptional care of him. It's hard to think about Bill without thinking of Jeanette. You two were the perfect team for walking through life together. Now, before long, Richard arrived and made them a family of three. During these days, it was busy, and financially, it wasn't easy. I can remember going to their apartment at UBC and finding only a package of wieners in the fridge. Bill would go to school during the day, but even in the evening, he worked for Macmillan Blodell in the sawmill as he tried to support his little family. And even in those days, Bill and Jeanette's home was always open to anyone, and they were willing to share whatever they had. Bill and Jeanette were blessed with six beautiful children: Richard, Jeff, Michael, James, Natalie, and Stephanie. Precious Michael passed away in 1977, but it is so comforting to know that Bill is now together with not only Jesus, but Michael, Mom and Dad Standerwick, Mom and Dad Estragolo, and so many other loved ones. Bill was so proud of each of his kids and loved to talk about whatever they were up to. He also loved his daughter-in-law, Laurel, son-in-law, Zach, but oh, how he adored the grandkids, and they adored him. Family was very important to Bill, and he loved to be a part of whatever they were doing. He loved when the kids would pop over for a swim. He loved all the family get-togethers, or simply if someone came over to sit and watch a hockey game with him. He always had time for his family, and I know they're going to miss his presence, his laughter, his wisdom, and his guidance. But let me back up a little bit. After graduating, Bill bought a dental practice on Fraser Street, and I'm sure some of you here were once his patients. He always worked hard as he had a passion for his work, his patients, and his staff. Bill genuinely loved people and wanted to hear what they wanted to share with him, whether it was about their spouses or children, or just life in general. Going to the dentist was truly so much fun, as his bigger-than-life personality filled the office with care, joy, and laughter. Bill loved sports. During his high school years, he went on the wrestling team, but he also played soccer. And as we were growing up as a family, I came to realize that our family were like many others that didn't have a lot of money. I can remember one day, Bill got a new pair of soccer cleats, and he was so excited. But what I came to realize is that these new boots were actually way too big for him. Bill was able to still play soccer that year and score goals. But then the second year of the new cleats, they fit perfectly, and Bill was again able to play, and he scored goals. The third year of these soccer boots, his feet were really squished into them, but he still laughingly and joyfully played and scored goals. He was always thankful. Bill also really enjoyed golfing, even in his wild plaid pants, and skiing at Whistler, but he also loved hockey. He loved to coach, but he loved to play. He was always so excited when September would come around, as that meant hockey season was approaching, and he could play three times a week with an incredible group of his friends. Bill truly valued his friendships, whether from childhood or those he made as an adult, as all were very, very important to him. And I know that we'll all have wonderful memories to cherish. Bill accepted Jesus into his heart as his Lord and Savior as a child. His faith was very important to him, and he was always ready to share the good news with anyone. His heart's desire was for his children and his grandchildren to love Jesus, to know God's word, and to walk daily with him. Bill always wasn't alert in the last couple of weeks, but Jeanette called me one morning to tell me that she walked into the room as he was praying the Lord's Prayer. You know, Bill also served the Lord with joy over the years, whether it was in Boys Brigade, as a deacon, a Bible study leader, on the finance committee, and in many other ministries, including the men's only Bible study. Another reason Bill really loved September approaching was that he knew the guys' study was starting again. The deep friendships he had with these men were very precious to him. He looked forward each week to welcoming this group into his home, studying God's word together, sharing Jeanette's amazing baking, and always inviting more men to join this study. I know he felt very loved and supported and cared for by these men during the difficult journey he was on, which he did with courage and dignity. During the last weeks, I never told my brother more how much I loved him. And from the bottom of my heart, Jeanette, I want you to thank you for putting him on the phone so that we could connect, I could hear his voice, and we can just kind of love on each other. It was a privilege in the last weeks to watch Jeanette and Rich and Jeff and Laurel and James and Natalie and Zach and Stephanie love their dad. They were the grandkids too. They surrounded him with love. And the care they gave was so sacrificial. I was just amazed. It was just so beautiful to see. You know, we have lost an amazing, amazing godly man who was filled with love, joy, and laughter. But now heaven is getting to enjoy him. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Beth. That was good. As we think about that, did you ever ask the question, why? Why do we have to go through all of this? What is the meaning of life? What happens when one dies? I mean, we have beautiful cemeteries and in our cities, but do we ever think that one day I'll be there? What is our hope? And as believers in Christ, our hope is in the Lord. In fact, as I read 1 Corinthians 15, I'm just going to read this to you, what the Apostle Paul says, starting in verse 50. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on the immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. And as I read this passage, we see that there will be a day when we shall be changed, a day when Jesus will come and all of us will change, when we're ready in the Lord. But we also know that we might go. There might be a day that God has chosen. He is the author of our lives, and there's a day that God has appointed to die, and then after that, the judgment. In fact, in James chapter 4 and 14 says, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. The Bible is so clear that our time on earth is very short. 100 years is really nothing compared to all eternity. For in Revelations 14:11 tells us that eternity is forever, forever where there is no day or night. Our eternal state is with the Lord, or if we do not know the Lord, forever away from God. We need to be ready here on earth to prepare our hearts, to trust in him. And it's really times like this that we begin to think of our eternal state. Are we putting our trust in God? Is God the center of our lives? The scripture is clear that there is an eternal state. We will not be sleepy. We will see the Lord. We come here today to celebrate the life of Bill. But what does that really mean? Is it just to cushion our thoughts about death? No, we're saying that Bill made a decision. He turned his life to Jesus Christ. As we heard already from Beth, that there was a point in his life that he heard the gospel message and he opened his heart. And he said, Jesus, come into my heart. And that is why we celebrate, because of what Jesus did in Bill's life. Therefore, I can say today that Bill finished well. It's not all the good things that he's done. The greatest work that he ever did was when he surrendered his life to Christ. Because Bill knew that this body is a perishable body. In fact, we know that our body is leading to death. The Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:1, for we know that if the tent, that is our earthly home, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The Apostle Paul longed to see Jesus come again, but he also realized that he might just die, broken in every way. But he also knows that one day he will receive a new body. Now, why did Bill finish well? Because he is now in a place where there is no more tears, no more sorrows, or no more sickness. We also see that we are buried, broken, but raised in glory, the scripture says. The Apostle Paul realized that when we are buried, someone we see is a man who was sick, who had trials in life, but then he had this joy, this spirit that is in him. And that's exactly how the Apostle Paul had. He was in prison, and yet he displayed such joy in his life. Whenever I went and had an opportunity to go side the bedside of Bill, I would read scripture and I would pray with Bill. Bill never told me to stop, but he wanted to hear the word of God. He had this joy. It wasn't anything else. It was that hearing God's word that gave him that joy of following Christ. The joy in the believer's heart is to know that we will have a new body, that great hope that we have as Christians. Then we see that we are buried in weakness, but raised in power. And when we begin to read our Bible, we begin to see that God is the author of our lives, continually working in our hearts, that progressive sanctification. And you see, my friends, the best thing that Bill did was take the word of God. He also prayed the Lord's Prayer to prepare his life to meet the Lord. His faith was not in the doctors that we have here, although they're great doctors, but at the end the patient dies. His trust was not in the bank account to see how much money he has in there, or even the recent development of these new medicines that are coming out. But it was on Christ. And in this word, the word of God brought comfort to Bill. Many of you might have heard of a famous poet named Elizabeth Barrett. Before she became famous, she married a man named Robert Browning. Her dad was dead against this marriage. And because of that, she was madly in love with him and married him, and there was division amongst the family. However, Elizabeth wrote to her parents every week, telling them that she loved them and longed for reconciliation. After 10 years, her father rejected her and her son, and she received a huge box in the mail that contained all the notes that she had sent. Not one had been opened. And these love letters have now become a precious part of classical English literature. It's really sad to think that her dad never picked that up and read it. Perhaps if he just read one of those, that his heart would have softened and he would have accepted Christ. He would have accepted his daughter. But see, that's the same as we look at life. There is a point in our life that we need to be ready. Are we reading God's word? Are we praying and trusting in him? Bill is no longer here with us today. But as I read these words from the Apostle Paul, it says, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks are to God, be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Bill accepted Jesus with joy, and so there was this tremendous joy in his life. As we already heard, he has been a blessing to many, many of his patients. And I had a number of them come to me and says, Bill was my dentist. He opened his home through the youth group. I remember going there, Jeanette was telling me that the young people were swimming in the swimming pool and just enjoying their time there. He didn't have to do that, but he did it. And he also loved the men's group. I remember him coming and talking about reaching out to men to live a life of godly life. So I conclude with this, with the words in the Bible. It says, your labor is not in vain. Bill gave it all to Christ. What an example. And that is a good thing as believers in Christ, is that we live our lives for him, trusting in him. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for the very words of God that speaks to us. And Father, as we are grieving and going through this journey of grief, we realize that our dependence is on you. Lord Jesus, you are the author of our lives, and you have brought us here. The beginning and the end, you know exactly the day that we shall leave this world. We are like the grass of the field. One minute we're here, next we're gone. So, Father, I pray that today we will make sure that our heart is right with God. So, Father, we thank you for the word of God, and I pray for the family. Encourage them through this journey. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the I'm Brittany. I was one of the granddaughters. I'm just going to read Ecclesiastes 3, verse 4. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity. Under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, and a time to weep and a time to laugh.
Okay. So I'm going to be reading John chapter 14. Verse 27. Okay. So this verse has significance, a significant meaning to my grandmother. For those of you who don't know, my grandma and grandpa lost their little son Michael many years ago when my dad and Uncle Rich were just little boys. When Michael was in the hospital and my grandma and grandpa didn't know if he was going to live or die, my grandma went into a room by herself with her Bible. She prayed and asked God to show her. She opened her Bible randomly and put down her finger. It was John chapter 14, verse 27. My peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. When my grandma and Auntie Natalie were with Grandpa, my Auntie Natalie asked Grandma to read the daily devotional. It was about peace. And the very last reference at the bottom of the page was John chapter 14, verse 27. My peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. My grandma said that this verse was one that God gave her when Michael died. She wondered if God was telling her that Grandpa was going home. That night, my grandpa passed away. It was a way of God showing my grandma that he was in control and would take care of her. My peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. Thank you.
Welcome, and thank you all for coming. For those of you who don't know me, my name is James. I'm the middle child, the third of the boys. Thank you, Auntie Beth, for your lovely tribute. Emily and Brittany, as well, for your scripture reading. It was lovely. We are here to celebrate the life of our father, known to some as Dr. Standerwick, others as Coach, others as Bill, and to us as Dad. To start, I'd like to touch on the circumstances of his passing, not because we want sympathy, but so we won't continually have the same conversation and have to relive the pain that he went through in the end. I know it was a shock to many, and I want you to know that if you did not know he was sick, it was by design. So please don't take it personally, because he played his cards close to his chest, because he wasn't one for pity, and wanted to enjoy his last days living normally, free from always talking about his sickness. Our dad had cancer, prostate that later metastasized into his bones and other areas of his body. He had undergone different treatments for years that held off the proliferation, but eventually the cancer was too much. Frankly, the last few months were extremely painful for him, and at times horrific, but our father, never the quitter, lasted longer than anyone could have imagined, giving us some lasting memories that we will treasure. All right, so enough with that. I don't need to tell you how tough he was. Anyone who played hockey against him already knows. So we are here to celebrate. Whether it was through his friendship, kind advice, generous love, his leadership, coaching, attention to detail in his work, or possibly a couple of slashes on the ice, you're here because Dad had some sort of impact on your life. And if you're here because of us as children, I assure you that nothing good you see in us is from his teaching based on the Word of God. Our father had a special kind of love for everybody. It was rooted in his relationship with Jesus. He loved to talk about the Bible, and I'd just like to touch on one of the things that we often talked about that had a special impact on me. It is easy to open up the Bible or go to Sunday school and learn the who, what, when, where, and how, but the why is what really interested my dad. Because when you start to understand the why, you start to understand God. Specifically, Dad loved to talk about look at the Old Testament, and that's the old stories in the beginning of the Bible for you unchurched folks. To show how they pointed to Jesus' life, death, resurrection, and ultimate return. Beyond the 300-plus fulfilled prophecies about where he'd be born, how he'd be born, family lineage, how he'd die, etc., he loved to talk about Christ types, stories with people who were foreshadowing Jesus' life. From Abraham and Isaac, demonstrating God's grace and how he would send his son to die willingly for us, being saved by God's grace, not by our own good works. To Joseph, being despised by his family, who was falsely accused and sold and suffered greatly. Then, after marrying a Gentile woman, bringing her into the Abrahamic lineage, foreshadowing Christ and his bride, the church. He ultimately provided salvation for the Gentiles and his family from famine and death. To Jonah, being thrown overboard to save the rest of the crew, and then being inside the whale 3 days, foreshadowing Christ 3 days in the tomb before saving Nineveh with the message of repentance. And one of the clearest examples is David, the shepherd, prophet, king. He fought a representative battle for his people to save them, who, though he had done nothing wrong, suffered and was persecuted at the hands of Saul and responded with love and peace, and who had a betrayer when his plot was discovered, hung himself. The prophet Ezekiel often called David, called the future redeemer David. And finally, to Moses, which is my personal favorite because it mirrors the book of Revelation and foreshadows our salvation. with his rejection, starting a new family representing the church, and then going back to ultimately save his people before bringing them all together to enter into the promised land, foreshadowing Christ's rejection, return, and our ultimate salvation. Now I could go on to mention a bunch more, Boaz, Jeremiah, Job, Joshua. But I'll just say that if you'd like to hear more about this stuff, Pastor Ray is sitting just over here. You sure he'd be happy to discuss them with you, or alternatively, the men's Bible study that my father enjoyed so much, which meets Wednesday afternoons here at Willingdon. Now, you may be asking yourself why I'm talking about Jesus so much when it's Bill's funeral. Jesus is why Dad was the way he was. His joy, love, patience, kindness, self-control, his honesty, generosity, and humble nature, the reason he was slow to anger and quick to forgive, the reason he didn't delight in evil and rejoiced in truth because of what Jesus did in his heart. All the wonderful things about my father were because of his love for Jesus. And there's nothing he would have loved more, even in his death, than to share that all with you. In closing, I'd like to thank everyone here for their love and support for our family. Your thoughts, prayers, and words of encouragement are appreciated.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming. I know Dad would have been so happy to see you guys. I really want to tell you what he was like at home and all of the time. The person that a lot of you know was someone who is always very kind, who spoke very kindly, and I want you all to know that that was what he was like at home. That was what he was like all of the time. He used beautiful words like, good morning, honey, and why, yes, honey. And then every waiter, every homeless person, all these different people you would meet, rich or poor, big and small, doesn't matter what your background, he was always very kind and said, well, it's very nice to meet you, and greeted them with kind eyes and a smile. And actually, a lot of my friends have said that one thing they remember about him is he has very kind eyes. And he did. All the time he did. My mom told me that he said to her every day, have I told you I love you today? And he said that every day. So, yeah, he was kind all the time. I never heard him yell at my mom. And he never yelled at us. Well, not that I can remember. My brother says, well, you remember a little differently than me. But he was so kind to us. I'm so impressed because you don't meet a lot of people like that that are really that genuinely kind and patient. Generosity, there's a whole bunch of things that we found about my dad that we had no idea. So when he was in the final days of his life, we were going through his things and we found that we knew that he had some sponsored children, but we found a whole bunch of sponsored children that we had no idea about. He had more than a dozen sponsored children, and he never talked about it, never told us. My brother also found a picture in a card of a little boy wearing a bunch of hockey gear. And it was a thank you card saying, thank you so much for buying my son hockey gear so he could play hockey. It was a patient of his who was a single mom and couldn't afford to put her son in hockey, so my dad helped her. And he never told us. So he really was that kind and generous of a person, even in secret. Many people, when they think of my dad, think about his laughter and think about his joy. He was joyful. And if you sat in the waiting room at his office, you would have probably heard him laughing down the hall. And whenever I was in there, I worked there, and there was laughing all the time. They laughed all the time. Because he had a hilarious sense of humor and found joy in everything. And one example that I would like to give you is there's this instrument called the molar chisel. And he was in the office and he was sitting there with Gabby and he goes, you know what? He goes, the molar chisel. That's just too scary of a name. I don't want anyone to hear molar chisel. He goes, we need a better name for this, you know, than hand me the molar chisel. He goes, how about hand me the Bambi. That's
That sounds nice. Send me the Bambi. And so from then on, he would say, Gabrielle, could you please hand me the Bambi instead of the molar chisel? And that was just one of the examples of how he would find joy in everyday little things. He did that all of the time. Dad didn't care about material things. He was into function, not fashion. He loved his same old T-Bird year after year. And he talked about other cars, but no, he was like, meh, why? He loved his functional Tilly hat, his plaid golfing pants, and T-shirts that said hilarious things. There was not a pretentious bone in his body. He just was very authentic and loved to love people. So yes, he really did care about people. Many people have told me that they felt loved by my dad, and that was because he really did. He would be laughing with everyone, all different backgrounds, in like 2 seconds. One time, a homeless man locked himself in the bathroom at the office, and so my dad ordered pizza, and coaxed him out of the bathroom, said, sorry, you can't live in my bathroom, but here, let's have dinner, and they sat and talked and laughed, and that's just who Dad was. Lastly, my favorite memories with him are going for walks. He loved to go for walks, especially around Deer Lake. He loved golfing. And he loved to talk about biblical prophecy. We would sit down, and if you asked him a question about the Bible, you could be sitting there for like a good 4 hours. He loved to relate it to current events and talk about how world affairs and current things that were going on fit in and tied in with God's calendar of what was going to be happening. He loved it. So, yeah, my dad, he really was that kind all of the time. He really was that joyful and that happy all of the time. And he was such a blessing to us and such a blessing to everyone around us and in our family. I'm really going to miss him. But I'm so thankful for such a long time that we did have him. And so God has shown us in this time that he's in control and that we've had many different circumstantial things and miracle things showing us that God is really in control. And if you want to hear about any of them, they're pretty neat. Come and talk to me. I'll talk to you later. So we know that Dad is safe in God's hands. So today is a day of joy and sadness, but we can all know that one day it's possible you can go and when you go to heaven, you'll hear him laughing. And so right now he's laughing in heaven. Thank you very much.
My dad was nothing short of an exceptional man, and I know that all of you know that and can attest to that, and that's why we're here. And I'm just so overwhelmed right now to see how many people are here to join us in remembering and honoring him. So thank you very much for coming. The best thing about my dad was that he reminded me about what God is like. The way he treated my mom and his kids, his friends, strangers, the needy, those in authority, he always treated everybody with respect. He was sacrificial, extremely generous, loving, kind, gentle, patient, tender, strong, wise, faithful, hardworking, just, humble, and forgiving. He really did embody what it means to live righteously, and his character was a direct reflection of Jesus. He taught me so many valuable lessons, and I'm so grateful for his wisdom in my life. He encouraged me to read my Bible and not just simply attend church, but to study and check that what I was hearing was true. He taught me to think for myself. His leadership in our family was one of gentleness and safety, which allowed my self-confidence to blossom. He taught me to be realistic and reasonable, and help me to develop an informed skepticism so that I could stay safe in the midst of a fallen world. And he modeled how to be wise and generous with the blessings that God gives, and how to be a lifelong learner. Some of my favorite times together were golfing and working at the dental office in the summer. My dad would take Stephanie and I out on the golf course and teach us how to play, and we would spend the whole time just talking, laughing, sharing stories, and just having fun. There were a few summers that I spent working for my dad, and it made me admire him even more. I love the way he interacted with everybody. His authoritative but kind leadership, and of course the box A lunch at the Japanese restaurant down the street. And I love how he would always bring his giant coffee in that old English dimpled beer mug, and I would sit passenger of his Thunderbird. And he always left at 7:30 and not a minute later. And my mom would get up with him every morning, and she'd wave goodbye and close the garage door as we left. My dad didn't always have it easy, but he had joy in all circumstances. I bet the thing you'll remember most about my dad was his laugh. He was constantly smiling and laughing. And his happiness didn't depend on his circumstances. He had a joy rooted in an eternal perspective. When he was working three jobs and living in his car, when his baby Michael went to heaven, when he was diagnosed with cancer and endured incredible pain, through all of these things, his response was always praise and acknowledgement of God's sovereignty. God is good in all things, even this thing. When we share in Jesus Christ's suffering, we can grow to be more Christ-like. And my prayer is that through this horrible situation, that each of us can experience the sovereignty and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and grow to be more like him. My dad left behind a legacy, and he also left behind a family. So as we go from here, I ask that you think of how you can be supportive and encouraging to my mom especially. Whatever that looks like, a note about how Bill impacted your life, funny stories, popping by to chat or sending photos. As a community, I ask that you please lift her up especially. I'd like to pray, and I'm going to start the way my dad always did, around the table at mealtimes. You can pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all the good things you do for us and give to us. As we reflect on Bill's life, help us to please see your loving kindness. May we all grow deeper in our understanding of your beautiful gift of grace and forgiveness. Thank you that we have the assurance that Bill is now spending eternity laughing, dancing, and worshiping you in heaven. There is no greater joy than knowing you, Jesus. Thank you for giving us Bill as an example of what it means to be a follower of Christ. Bless us all with knowing you more deeply. And please grant us spiritual protection and peace with this huge change. And in our loneliness, help us cling to you. And in our wrestling, help us turn to the Bible and seek out truth. I pray that we all approach our death day the way Bill did, singing praise to you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Well, good afternoon, and welcome to my father's memorial. It's nice to see a nice turnout today, which I would expect anyways, but it's nice to see it come to fruition. You know what? I've had the good fortune of having a fantastic father who taught me how to be successful in all areas of life. It's only when I grew older that I realized how fortunate I was. That not everybody actually gets what I had and what our family had. My wife works for an organization that works with young disadvantaged mothers, and I've been able to see firsthand the hardships caused by either non-existent or abusive fathers. So I'm pretty thankful for what I had, and I was lucky enough to be able to tell him so as well. So, you know what, if you haven't told anyone in your life what you feel, you might want to, because you never know what's gonna happen. That's the advantage of cancer, is that it takes a little while, and you have the opportunity to say what you want to say and do what you want to do before you die. Not everybody's gonna get that chance. So as our family watched Dad's condition deteriorate in front of our eyes, it must be noted the love affair that he's had with my mom for over 46 years. don't cry on me, Mom. My dad would often call my mother endearing names, bring her flowers quite often, which my wife would duly note. He'd dip kiss her in the kitchen. He would ask her daily, "Have I told you that I loved you today?" And there was no questioning his love for her, and likewise her love for him. In these days, the only time my mother left his side the whole time was when she wore herself out and she was literally too sick to be near him. Otherwise, she was spending ridiculous hours tending to his every need. If you know my mom, you know she's a warrior and will take on any, and I mean any, task that needs to be done. Dad, my father, he was pretty fun to be around. As, you know, if you guys knew him, and you all did, you know, he was a blast. And we laughed to the very end, even in the hospital. I mean, we have that particular sense of humor, you know, like he's sitting there, he's in pain, he's like, "Kill me now." And I could grab a pillow and put it over his head and he'd laugh, you know. We had a good time. We're laughing at the guy who replaced him. You know, he was moaning in the one room, so they stuck him in his own room. And the guy that was in the last room, he was going, "Oh yeah, thank goodness, this guy's not gonna be moaning in my room." Well, I go back there the next day, and the guy that replaced him, he's screaming, you know, he's, "Ah!" And me and my dad, we're laughing about that. You know, thinking, careful what you wish for, right? If you were funny enough, you had the privilege of hearing his laugh go from one like the count to the high-pitched squeak where you thought he'd pass out from lack of oxygen, often grabbing, you know, supporting himself on his knees. A characteristic of my dad that I personally valued was that he generally cared about people. And he really did care about people, and he really had no time for people that didn't care about people. An example of this is when Dad was in the hospital and my mom came back from being sick. After greeting my mom, the first thing he did was ask about a friend who was having medical problems. He's like, "Hey, how are they doing?" You know, that's the first thing he asked. You know, it's not selfish, not anything else. It's, "Hey, how are our friends doing? Are they okay?" You know, and that's just the way he was. You know, he was always willing to give advice to those who would listen and help anyone out who would accept it. Our family's heard countless stories, and especially now that he's died, we keep hearing more and more from people that my dad's helped over the years, and I feel fortunate to have had access to that every day, all of us. It's really quite the blessing. If he ever tried to help you, I can assure you he had no ulterior motives, and other than just to better your situation. He always reinforced the value of hard work by his example and his counsel. He came up with such maxims as work first, play second. Usually said that one to me. You don't have to work, you get to work. Or the other things, you know, you'd say, "Oh, I gotta go do this today." He goes, "No, you don't have to do it, you get to do it." The thing behind it was that he taught us to seek opportunity and just be thankful of the situations that you were in and that you got to do. Dad loved hockey. He really loved hockey. Playing, coaching, you know, he coached for most of his life. He coached hockey, among other sports such as soccer, for almost 40 years. He loved trading stories, talking hockey anytime and place, anywhere. And it was funny, you know what? During the time where it looked like he was going to get better at a time, you know, he went into the hospital, he came out, looked like he was going to, you know, maybe make another recovery. There was two things that he said he really wanted to do. And one of them was that he'd really like to get another season of hockey and show the guys what he could do. He figured he was going to take it to you guys this year. Unfortunately, not, but... yeah, I still remember he'd come home and he'd tell his hockey stories. He'd go, man, I was zooming down the right wing and I cut over here. And I look at him, I go, Dad, I've seen you guys play. There was no zooming involved. Which, he was laughing. The other thing he was hoping to do was spend one more year with his grandchildren. He really loved spending time with his grandchildren. And especially in this case, Brooklyn and Caleb. He really loved the little ones, as we all do in the family. And this segues to the reality that Dad really loved family, and he stressed that importance to us. He always stressed to his children that it was important for family to get along and be close. And it was always a source of sadness for Dad when members of his family were not getting along. Really bothered him, and you could visually see it if that was happening. As a result, you know, we have a pretty close-knit family today, and it was a blessing for us all to be able to spend time with Dad in his last days. Most importantly, Dad taught us how to love God and have wisdom to do what's right, which I find kind of funny with our memorial here. Oh, sorry. With our memorial here, as a firefighter, I get to attend our firefighter funerals and stuff, and I can come back to the hall, and sometimes guys will go, "Whoa, that was kind of churchy, that funeral," and I'm looking and thinking, "Well, if that's the way you feel, you've come to the wrong place today," so, or perhaps the right place, who knows? Anyways, Dad always reinforced the Bible's God's instruction manual for how to live your life. And so I'm going to attempt to relay some of the lifetime of instruction within a limited number of minutes. Anything else I missed, you're going to have to read a couple books. The reasoning is that most of you know what my dad has done, what he's accomplished in his life, but like James touched on, the more important topic is the why. Right? If you know why you're doing something, what you do is going to have much more of an impact, right? So this why is his relationship with God, and I want to share with you some of the basis for this belief. So Dad had a scientific mind, being going through science and dentistry and medical school, and he loved to study and research in order to find the truth, and that passed on to us. And so the reason of this belief and the what he believed comes down to, does God exist? And if God exists, you know, which one's the right one? So with me and him, we love talking apologetics. So apologetics is just basically defending the belief of God and why you do it. So just starting with the creation of the universe, you know, just the odds of, you know, a big bang happening by accident or 10 to the power of 123, meaning it's scientifically impossible. So in reaction to this, some people have come up with ideas such as multiple universes and dimensions. I mean, I'm not going to get into string theory and the different things, but basically all I can, I'll shorten it down. The problem is there's absolutely no evidence for multiple universes or dimensions. And these theories rely on if-then statements, which is like me saying, if I was 7'5", I'd be playing the NBA. So they just have no basis in reality. And the creation of the universe was just so exact that the only logical explanation is that there had to be a creator. And you have like quantum physicists such as Dr. Amit Goswami, you know, he stated that you can't just have matter come into motion without someone, in this case, putting in motion. He says in the case of the Big Bang, it's a quantum paradox, and that there's no other explanation but God. So there's a myriad of other relational topics you could look into, such as the law of entropy, the oddity of planets and galaxies coming into existence from an explosion when explosions usually wreck things. There's a myriad of topics that you can investigate. In regards to life on Earth, the same need for God exists. Biochemistry professor Dr. Dean Kenyon used to be thought of a leading mind in his field, and that was until his research led him to conclude that there's no chance of life being created by accident, and then which his cohorts were not happy with his findings, and he wasn't in the club anymore. As he learned more about DNA, he found that it would be impossible for proteins to self-assemble without DNA. Even a one-celled organism would require a textbook of written instructions in DNA. In other words, you can only have natural selection with DNA, but natural selection would have been required to create DNA in the absence of God. So it really is, again, another paradox that just doesn't work. For those of you wondering about dinosaurs, they take place before Genesis 1, chapter 1, verse 2. This is too long of a topic to discuss here. You're going to have to do your own research if you're interested. I'll just leave it with you that the original text in Hebrew reads, "Now the earth became formless," rather than often written, "was formless." But it's at least noted in the NIV Bibles. In regards to evolution, the actual fossil record does not actually support the evolutionary theory. This, again, is a ridiculously huge topic that you'll have to do your homework on. But I, again, encourage you to read with an investigative mind and an open mind. One of my favorite examples, and Dad's favorite examples, actually, was Nebraska Man, which was actually a fossilized tooth. But nonetheless, Nebraska Man was depicted in textbooks showing, his form and head shape and, how he would have lived. With the advance of DNA technology, this tooth was actually found to be a pig's tooth. So, anyways, that's, just saying that more research by yourself should be encouraged to actually search out for the truth. It's also curious to note that there's never once been a fossilized animal in the stage of transition into another animal. There are many examples that I could point to for the existence of God scientifically, but for the sake of time, I'll move on to why Dad believed in Jesus as his Lord and Savior. The historical facts are Jesus was a real person. Jesus' tomb was found empty on the Sunday after his crucifixion. Several groups experienced the appearance of Christ after the tomb was empty. And this is why there's so many people and places noted in the New Testament. And so if anyone had any seen anything or wanted anything verified, they could go to those places and towns and talk to those people and verify that truth. The people who saw the resurrected Jesus believed so strongly that they were willing to die just to relay the message that he gave them. He was also the only person involved with a major religion that made the claim of being God. And even James touched on the statistical impossibility of all the prophecies that were fulfilled by Christ. I think the odds are, again, astronomical. The Bible has been scrutinized for centuries and has never been once proved wrong. The closest was the city of Bethesda, which they couldn't find when they looked for it, but eventually they did a little bit more digging and they found it in the exact place it was supposed to be. My dad loved reading the book of Revelation, which describes the end times on the earth. And the purpose of this book of the Bible is to prove the Bible's truth to those living in these times. Dad loved noting what had already taken place and anticipating how Revelation would be fulfilled in the future. These were but a few of the reasons my dad had for the belief in God, and I know he would encourage each one of you to research the topic some more, and his belief in Jesus Christ as his Christ and Savior greatly impacted the way he lived his life. It provided the motivation for how he lived each day. Now, the reality of the situation is that everyone in this room is going to die one day. And the fact is, sadly enough, that the memory of you will fade over each generation, even if you were as great as my dad. The questions you need to ask yourself are, what's going to happen to you when you die? And what's the legacy you're going to leave behind? My dad worshiped God even in his attitude about dying. As he lay in the hospital bed, he mused that the one thing everyone seems to be scared of is dying. But he wasn't. I'm so thankful for my dad and the legacy that he left behind. His legacy is evident as you talk with people he knew. He had such a huge impact on us, especially as his children, in his love and the truth that he spoke. Thank you.
Yes, I'm gonna walk that milky white way. Oh Lord, some of these days. Well, I'm gonna walk that milky white way. Some of these days. Well, 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 well. I'm gonna walk up and take my stand. I'm gonna walk that milky white way. Oh Lord, some of these days. I'm gonna tell my mother howdy, 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 when I get home. Yes, I'm gonna tell my mother howdy when I get home. Well, 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 I'm gonna shake my mother's hand. I will shake her hands that day. That's when we walk that milky white way. Oh Lord, one of these days. I'm gonna meet God the Father. And God the Son.
And God the Son.
Yes, I'm gonna meet God the Father. And God the Son. Well, 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 well. I'm gonna sit down and tell him my troubles about the world I just came from. That's when I will walk that milky white way.
Passing by, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus. Spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus. Your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side, and fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live.
Bill lived a blessed life. And earlier this week, Jeanette and the Standerwick committee met and said, Ray, benediction, say something. Don't just pray, but 7 minutes. So you are blessed. Bill was obviously much loved. When some of our church leaders went to pray for him a number of weeks ago, they asked him, what would you like us to pray for? And Bill immediately said, I want to go to heaven. When it comes to heaven, the most read, most beloved text is John 14, verses 1 through 6. And Jesus is encouraging his disciples. Bill was an encourager. I remember him encouraging me in the stairwell of our church. Jesus says to them, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. That word believe means to trust. So Jesus was saying to his disciples, believe in God, trust in me, no matter what the circumstance. And Emily and Brittany already referred to John 14, verse 27, which encouraged Jeanette when Michael passed away, and also when Bill passed away. Jesus invites us to trust him. Bill had a way of making people trust him. Maybe it was his laugh. People enjoyed sitting in his dentist chair. I find that amazing. I wish he would have been my dentist. I would have loved to have come under that Bambi. Why should we trust Jesus? Listen to what he says. Verse 2, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. In my Father's house are many rooms. Jesus refers to heaven as a home. And the picture is of a Jewish home where sons would add to the father's house. And so the estate would grow. It would house the extended family. There'd be a large compound around a communal courtyard. So for Jesus' disciples, when Jesus speaks of the Father's house, they would imagine family, relationship, good times. I love that image of heaven that Jesus uses, of a big house for extended family with room for all. I'm sure Jesus has employed Bill as a greeter, a welcomer. He had this wonderful gift of making people feel welcome. Maybe it was the big laugh. I remember going to his Bible study one time, big hug, big welcome, lots of desserts on the island in the temple. on the table. It was kind of a temple. But multiple desserts, and I think the only rule was, eat all you can. Our reunion in heaven will be an awesome family reunion. Lots of food on the table for sure. Lots of time to play hockey. Bill now flying, zooming down the wing, streaking across the front of the net, tucking the puck under the crossbar, not just in his mind, but doing it. Jesus has prepared a room for Bill. He's made it ready. Thomas, one of the disciples, he has questions. He's audacious, courageous, apprehensive. He asks in verse 5, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? He doesn't understand, so he asks. Bill asks questions. It sounds like he had some long answers as well. But the good thing about God is that he's not afraid of our questions. And so if we have questions, we should ask. God has answers. Jesus said to Thomas, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If there ever was a summary of the message of Jesus, it's that statement. I'm the way, not just a way, not just pointing a way, not just blazing a trail. I am the way. I'm the truth. I am reality defined. If you want to know the truth, then come to me. I'm the life. Jesus said it in so many ways. I'm the bread of life. I'm the door to life. I'm the light of life. I'm the good shepherd who offers you abundant life. If you want life, then come to me. And life, of course, is knowing God. To be alive is to know God. How did Jesus offer us life? Well, if truth was ever revealed, it was when Jesus went to the cross and died for humanity. If there ever was a statement of God's love for us, it was in that moment. Jesus on the cross, dying for us, taking our sin upon himself so that God's wrath might be appeased, his wrath towards sin, so that there might be actually a way into the Father's presence through Jesus. Jesus, just this overwhelming statement of God's love for us, the way, the truth, and the life. When we're in relationship with Jesus, we have heaven within us, now and forever. The essence of heaven, it's not about going to another place, it's about knowing God, about being with him, it's about being in his house. Bill believed in Jesus. He was ready for heaven. Trusted Jesus as Lord and Savior, as the family has already testified. That's why we can say with confidence that Jesus has ushered him into the Father's house, that Bill has been taken to his room, and that he will be with God forevermore. So Jesus says to all of us today, I've gone to prepare a place for you. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Trust me. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you, Jesus, for coming, for revealing to us the truth, revealing to us the Father. Thank you for opening the way into the Father's presence through your death and resurrection. Thank you for the gift of forgiveness, for the gift of eternal life, Thank you for the gift of knowing you. I pray your peace on the members of the Standerwick family, on Jeanette, on our children, the whole extended family, the grandchildren, friends, relatives that are here. Thank you, Lord, that you are present with us in each moment, that you never leave. And so I thank you that you will be present to comfort and to guide Jeanette and each member of the Standerwick family today and in the coming days. And may your name be lifted high. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus paid the price for our redemption, bought us back, and as we place our faith in him, the burden of our sins rolls away.
Rolled away, rolled away, every burden of my heart rolled away, rolled away, rolled away, rolled away. Every burden of my heart rolled away. Every sin had to go. Neath the crimson flow. Hallelujah! Rolled away, rolled away, rolled away. Every burden of my heart rolled away.
Hooray!
No one can sing quite like her ever since.
This man is here. Roll away.
Neath the crimson flow, hallelujah, rolled away, rolled away, rolled away. Every burden of my heart rolled away.
Hooray!
No one can sing quite like Grandpa sings. Even if they tried, they couldn't sing like that. I have a special kind of voice, took years of training.